Good morning, students. Today again we are coming to the next part of the benign and malignant tumors of oral cavity. So today we are seeing the part 2 of the epithelial pathology. So today in this particular session we are going to discuss about the malignant epithelial tumors of the oral cavity. Now we already finished in our previous discussions, we had finished the benign tumors of the oral cavity. So today we are going to talk about the malignant epithelial tumors of the oral cavity. Now oral squamous cell carcinoma is the commonest, one of the commonest cancers that you encounter in, especially in Indian males. When you look at the epidemiological studies, we will see that oral cancer or oral squamous cell carcinoma is the commonest cancer that we see among the Indian males. Now, what we need to understand is, like, even though there has been so many advances in the medical field, even now, even after doing all the kind of treatments, we are still not able to improve the prognosis of these oral cancers. Even now, the 5-year survival rate is below 50% in the case of oral cancers. Now, why is it so important for a dental surgeon? Now, what you need to remember is the oral cavity is an area where we usually work on. And most of the times, these cases, like, you know, we will be the first physicians, like, you know, who are going to encounter these kind of lesions, and we are the people who will be responsible in making the diagnosis for most of these cases. Because, like, only during a dental visit, there will be an opportunity for a physician to, or a doctor, to make a thorough examination of the oral mucosa, wherein which you'll be able to identify the starting point of these kind of lesions. That is where the importance of a dentist in the identification or early identification of these kind of cancers is going to occur. Now, what you need to remember is, if you can identify these cancers at a very early stage, there is a better prognosis or a better outcome for the patient. Now, still more important is, most of these cancers, like, is preceded by a lesion known as a precancerous lesion or a condition. So, something like this. So this is a stage before cancer. Okay. So if you are able to, as a dental surgeon, identify the disease at this particular point of time where it has not progressed into cancer, you can treat it at a very conservative way and you can save the patient's life. Because you know that once it has transformed into cancer, the third picture, the prognosis for the patient is very bad and the possibility to save the patient is very less. Because the 5-year survival rate is less than 50%. That means that if you follow up the patient after the treatment for 5 years, only 50% of them are going to survive this 5-year period. So we can avoid all that if you can identify these lesions in the stage before cancer. That is called the pre-cancer. In the pre-cancer stage, if you are able to identify them, you will be able to do a very conservative management, like a local excision in your dental chair itself under local anesthesia, and you can follow up the patient and you can save the patient. And you need to also counsel them to move away from their deleterious tobacco related habits, which has caused this particular lesion. So today we are going to discuss in detail about pre-malignant lesions and conditions of epithelial tissue origin. So what we are talking about here is, before it has turned into cancer, it goes through a previous stage. There was a stage before that where it has not transformed into cancer but on the way towards cancer. And if you can identify them at that particular point and if you can diagnose them properly, you can give a treatment where in which you can save somebody's life. Okay. So that is what I have been telling you. Most of the squamous cell carcinomas of the upper aerodigestive tract arises from non-invasive lesions of the squamous mucosa. When I say squamous cell carcinoma or a cancer, that means that we know that a normal epithelium is separated from the underlying connective tissue by means of a basement membrane. Okay, that is how the normal epithelium is going to work. Last class I had discussed in detail about, like, what are the features of a epithelium. The epithelium is always separated from the underlying connective tissue by means of a basement membrane. We have learned that in your first year. Now, when it becomes a cancer, it loses this particular characteristic feature of the epithelium, and they start invading into the underlying connective tissue as islands and cords and as individual cells. And they will acquire the ability to travel to distant sites in the human body, like, you know, leading to metastasis and eventually the death of the host. Okay, so if I want to diagnose a case as a squamous cell carcinoma, histologically I should be able to see the breach of the or break of the basement membrane and entry of the malignant tumor epithelial tumor cells into the underlying connective tissue. So I should be able to identify something like that. Then only I can diagnose it as a cancer. So before it reaches to this particular stage, there are some changes that is occurring in the epithelium. Okay. If I am able to identify these changes, I will know that whether it is in, I will be able to identify it in a pre-malignant state. Okay, so this stage, which is seen just before the cancer, which before the transformation into cancer, is a non-invasive stage. The basement membrane is still intact. Okay, so these non-invasive lesions are known as pre-malignant lesions, or we call them as pre-malignant lesions or conditions. So there are few terminologies that you have to remember or you have to understand before we go into these precancerous or the pre-malignant disease. So that includes pre-malignant lesions or precancerous lesions, precancerous conditions, and dysplasia. And what are the differences between all these things? The first one is a precancerous lesion. So the definition of a precancerous lesion is a benign. It's not turned into cancer till now. So it's still benign because there is no breach in the basement membrane. So it's still benign. A benign morphologically altered tissue. An area of the tissue is altered. And if you look in the oral cavity, you see a white patch. You see an area of white patch or a plaque. That is a morphologically altered area. When I look with my naked eyes, I will be able to see that there is some kind of a change over there in a localized area. Okay, so a benign morphologically altered tissue that has got a greater than normal risk of malignant transformation. So these kind of localized lesions on the oral cavity or any part of the body is known as a precancerous lesions. I am able to demarcate the area which has got the increased chance of undergoing malignant transformation. So I can see with the morphological alteration of the tissue, I can identify the area which has got the increased chances of turning into malignancy. That is known as a precancerous lesion. Now, what do you mean by a precancerous condition? It is a generalized state associated with significantly increased risk of cancer. A generalized disease state where any part of the oral cavity has got a chance of turning into malignancy. So you cannot identify or pinpoint a particular area in the oral cavity which has got an increased possibility to turn into cancer. No, not like that. Any part of the oral cavity, because it's a generalized state. Okay, so we will, as we are discussing these lesions in the coming days, it will become much more clearer for you this difference between a pre-malignant lesion and a condition as we are discussing each and each lesions. So a lesion means it is a morphologically altered area, a localized area in the oral cavity which has got an increased chance of turning into cancer, while a condition is a generalized state or a disease state where any part can turn into cancer. Every part has got an equal opportunity to turn into a cancer. So that's the basic difference between precancerous lesion and a condition. Now, it's all fine and good like that when we are seeing that and we identify it as a precancerous lesion and a condition. Now, how are we going to really measure or how are we going to really analyze how far it has reached towards cancer or towards becoming a cancer? Because we know that it is a journey towards cancer. Okay, a normal epithelium, because of some insult like a tobacco chewing or tobacco smoking, because of the exposure to carcinogen, the cells are getting altered and they are moving towards the stage of cancer. Okay, so how are we going to know, like, at what stage they are, or how much close are they to become a cancer? Okay, how close they are towards the formation of a cancer? So you can measure that only by taking a biopsy and examining them histologically. So what are you going to see in the histological picture? You're going to see the features very close to that of features or the cellular and the histological features very close to what you see in oral cancers. Okay, so what is basically in a cancer or a malignancy or a tumor? It is nothing but an uncoordinated excessive growth okay, an uncoordinated excessive growth. So the features of an increased proliferation will be seen when a lesion is moving towards cancer. Okay, because cancer is basically nothing but an uncoordinated excessive growth. So when a lesion is moving towards cancer, when you see their cells and when they see the histology of all the cells together, you will see features which suggest that the cells are undergoing an increased rate of proliferation or division. So those histological features will become evident when you are observing, when you are taking a biopsy of these precancerous lesions and conditions, and if you see them under the microscope. Okay, these histological features that you see when you take a biopsy from a precancerous lesion and a condition which suggests that they are moving towards cancer is known as dysplasia. This is known as dysplasia. Those cellular and histological features which is going to tell you that this precancerous lesion or condition is moving towards cancer, or like it is on the progression towards cancer. This particular cytological and histological features are known as dysplasia. So what does really dysplasia means? So what are we actually looking like, what are these features signifying? They actually signify the abnormal growth and maturation of the cells. One is, it increases at a very fast rate. The cell division is increased at a very fast rate. That is what you mean by abnormal growth. And the maturation has gone down, and even abnormal maturation can also be seen. The cells are not behaving in a normal way because they have undergone so much of mutation, so they have forgotten how it has to be, they have to behave in a normal way. So they will even start showing abnormal maturation and even lack of maturation. So abnormal growth and maturation is what you mean by dysplasia. So this is not something that you see clinically. You can see it only when you take a biopsy and you observe them under the microscope. So this is actually a histological connotation of the pre-malignancy. It's actually what you mean by dysplasia. It's actually the histological, at the histological level, what you see for a pre-malignancy is what you mean by dysplasia. Okay, so if you see a premalignant lesion or a condition, you have to take a biopsy and you have to see whether dysplasia is present or not. If it is present, how much is the dysplasia? You have to grade the dysplasia. Grading of dysplasia we will discuss in another session. So today we are going to only see what are the features, the cellular and the histological features of dysplasia. Now, before going into dysplasia, I just want to mention about the premalignant lesions and conditions. Now, we have already discussed the three important terminologies that you have to remember when we are talking about this precancerous lesions. That is the premalignant lesions, conditions, and dysplasia. So, both lesions and conditions are something that we categorize based on the clinical appearance and the clinical features and the pathogenesis. And dysplasia is common for all this. Whether it may be a premalignant lesion or a condition, the reason why you are taking a biopsy is you want to see whether dysplasia is present. If it is present, how much worse is this dysplasia? How much advanced is this dysplasia? How close is this dysplastic features, and how much close it is towards malignancy or towards cancer? Okay, now let's talk about what are the different lesions and conditions. Let us just enumerate them, and we are going to discuss them in detail later. Okay. So, under the lesions, we have leukoplakia, erythroplakia, actinic keratitis, smokeless tobacco-induced keratosis, parietal keratosis associated with reverse smoking. And under conditions, we have diseases like oral submucous fibrosis, erosive lichen planus, Plummer-Wilson syndrome, lupus erythematosus, dyskeratosis congenita, syphilis, xeroderma pigmentosum, and epidermolysis bullosa. So, these are all the pre-malignant condition, because condition is a generalized state. The whole body has been affected, and where in which there is an increased possibility of cancer in the oral cavity. While lesion is a localized lesion or a localized morphologically altered area in the oral cavity, and in that localized area alone there is a higher chances of malignant transformation. So I hope by now the lesions and conditions, the idea about the lesions and conditions are pretty clear for you. Now let's talk about dysplasia in detail. Now when we talk about dysplasia, we discuss dysplastic features under two headings. One is the changes that you see at the cellular level. We call that as the cytological ATPR. We are looking at each cell and seeing what are the changes that is there in each cell. That is what you mean by cellular ATPR. You put all these cells together, you're going to have the epithelial tissue. That is what you mean by histology. So it's just like if you're having bricks, each brick is a cell, and you put all these bricks together and you have a wall, that the wall is the histology. And imagine if the each of the bricks are not formed properly, each of the bricks are different and they are all crooked, and you try to make a wall with that particular brick, you're going to have an uneven wall or an abnormal wall. So if you have an abnormal cellular features, you're going to have an abnormal histological feature in the end, because the cells are being put together and that is how an epithelial tissue is being formed. So if you're trying to describe the dysplastic features, the dysplastic features can be described under two headings. First is at the cellular level, that is known as a cytological ATPR, and the next is at the histological level. You put all the cells together and you have the histology, the epithelial tissue is there, that is called the histology, and that is known as the architectural features. So basically we have cytological atypical features and we have architectural features. So let's see what are they. So under cytological ATPR, we have enlarged nuclei and cells, large and prominent nucleoli, increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, hyperchromatic nuclei, pleomorphic nuclei and cells, increased mitotic activity, and abnormal mitotic figures. And under architectural features, we have bulbous or teardrop-shaped retinages, loss of polarity, diskeratosis, and loss of cell cohesiveness. We will see each of these features in detail in the coming slides. So this is a non-keratinized epithelium, a normal non-keratinized epithelium that you see on the buccal mucosa. So I want you to have an idea about like how the histology of a normal epithelium or a normal buccal mucosa looks like. What you see on the top is basically the epithelial cells or the epithelial tissue. You can see that the epithelial tissue is separated from the underlying connective tissue by means, is completely separated. You cannot make out the basement membrane at this low power view, but you can make out that there is a clear separation between the superficial or the upper epithelium and the underlying connective tissue. So just keep this in your mind as just as a reference for what has to appear like a normal. Now, the first one is about the basilar hyperplasia. Okay. In the basilar hyperplasia, first what I have shown you is a normal histology of how the normal basal cells are supposed to look in a normal epithelium. So here you can see, I am pointing in a hyperbola view, you can see the white arrows showing the columnar basal cells, columna or cuboidal basal cells. And few parabasal cells can be seen above it with a prominent nuclei in the top. Only one or two layers will be there. That's not very prominent everywhere also. So what is prominent is only one or two layers of cells just above the basement membrane, just above the connective tissue. Okay, this is how in normal histology, you are supposed to see the basal layers. But when it comes to dysplasia, you're going to see that there is an increase in the number of the basal layers. Okay, so here you can see an increase, the blue arrows are pointing to an area where there is an increase in the layers of the basal layer. This is known as basilar hyperplasia. This is an indication of an increased rate of cell multiplication or cell proliferation. Okay, so basilar hyperplasia is one feature or one dysplastic feature. The second one is large and prominent nucleoli. If you look at the nucleus very closely in cells which are dysplastic, you will be able to see one is a nucleus, the blue arrow is pointing, the white arrow is pointing to a nucleus inside the cell, and inside the nucleus you are able to see the blue arrows are pointing to like nucleoli. So large and prominent nucleoli is another feature of dysplasia. Next is increased nucleus cytoplasmic ratio. In the case of a normal histology in a normal cell, I'm trying to show you the normal nucleus inside the cytoplasm. So here you can see a normal nuclei here in the spinous layer. The nucleus is not very prominent, it's very faint. You can see another nuclei here. As you can see the second arrow that has been pointed, you can see the nucleus size is very small when compared to that of the total cytoplasm. if the the cytoplasm is around 4 times more than that of the nucleus. It's very obvious here from the second arrow. You can see the cytoplasm size of the cytoplasm is around 4 times or 3 times to that of the nuclear size. So the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio in a normal cell, in a normal spinous cell or something, is around 1:4. That is, if one part is a nucleus, then the cytoplasm will be 4 times to that. Okay, so more cytoplasm will be there. But if a cell is in a dividing phase, what you're going to see is more number or the size of the nucleus will be really big, because it is filled with the deoxyribonucleic acids, the DNA, which is important for the cell division. Okay, just before cell division, there is a duplication of DNA and the chromosomes or the chromosomes. So the size of a dividing cell is going to be pretty big. And in the case of dysplasia, you will see that the size of the nucleus is so big that the nucleus cytoplasmic ratio is around 1:1. The nucleus almost fills up the whole of the cytoplasm. Okay, the whole of the cytoplasm will be, or the inside the cell will be completely occupied by the nucleus. So that is what you mean by the nucleus cytoplasmic ratio is around 1:1. So in a dividing cell, before the cell undergoes division, there is a multiplication of the chromosomes. So there is an increase in the DNA content inside the nucleus. So the nuclear size will increase. So a dividing cell will have a larger nucleus. So it is going to occupy most of the space inside the cell. So the nucleus cytoplasmic ratio in a dysplastic cell is going to be 1:1. When compared to that of a normal epithelial cell, where the nucleus cytoplasmic ratio is around 1:4. So this is another feature. The next feature is hyperchromatism. If you look at the dysplastic cell, the white arrow which is pointing to the dysplastic cell, to the nucleus, you will see that it has got more blue color than that of the normal counterpart. The nucleus of the dysplastic cell has got more blue color being taken in H&E staining than in the case of a normal counterpart in the normal histology. The reason is the blue color is being taken because of the uptake of the hematoxylin stain. When more DNA content is there, more hematoxylin uptake will be there for the nucleus. So, in a dysplastic cell, where the nuclear content, that is the chromosome has divided and more amount of chromosomes are there and DNA is there, in a dividing dysplastic cell, in a highly proliferating dysplastic cell, more hematoxylin uptake will be there for the nucleus, and you are going to see an increase in the color of the nucleus. Okay, that is what you mean by the hyperchromatic nuclei. So these two features goes hand in hand. You're going to see an increase in nucleus cytoplasmic ratio. You're also going to see a hyperchromatic nuclei. So these are all, again, the features of a dysplastic cell, a cytological atypical feature in a dysplastic cell. Now what I want to talk about is the pleomorphism. Pleomorphism means variation in the size and shape of the cell. If you look here in the normal histology of a buccal mucosa, you look at the spinous layer or the middle part of the epithelium, you can see that the cells and the nucleus has got almost uniform size and shape. Okay, they have almost uniform size and shape. Now you see a dysplastic cell. Okay, this was actually a slide which I had seen in my practice. So I'm going to show you an area. The yellow circle mark area, you look at the cells over there, you can see the variation. There is variation in the size and shape of the cells and the nuclei. This variation in the cell, the size and shape of the cell and the nuclei, is known as the pleomorphism. This is an important atypical feature that you see with dysplasia. So the variation in the size and shape of the cell is known as pleomorphism, and it's very evident with the dysplastic tissue. So again, this is another picture where all these features can be seen in one slide. This is again another case that I had seen. So what you need to remember is that you cannot pick each area and show only one feature. Sometimes you get all these features together in one area alone. So you can see here in the middle where the white arrows are being pointed, you can see some nuclei which are really big, hyperchromatic, the nucleus cytoplasmic ratio is really big. And the cells have got a lot of pleomorphism. They don't even look same. Some of them are really, has got bizarre shapes and sizes and shapes are there. Bizarre shapes are there for them. You can see all these kind of different cells. with hypochromatic nuclei and variation in the size and shape of the cells. All these things can be seen in one area, in one focus itself. Next one is about the increased mitotic figures. Now, what is mitosis? Mitosis is cell division. Okay. When you are undergoing, when the cell is undergoing division, that is what you mean by mitosis. Now, whenever there is an increased proliferation, if the cell, as we told you, dysplasia is a journey towards cancer, from normal to cancer, that in between journey is known as a dysplasia. So you're going to see that there is an increased proliferation of the cells during dysplasia, in dysplasia, or in this pre-cancer stage. So when the cell is undergoing division, it goes through certain stages. That is a prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. We have learned that in your plus two classes. But histologically, you will be able to identify these stages of cell division in the tissues. Normally also, you will be able to see them in the basal layer, because basal layer is the only layer in the normal epithelium, where you're going to see the cell division. Because we know that when the cells reach a stratum spinosum, you are going to see that the ability of the cells to undergo division is lost. So you can, in a normal epithelium, you are supposed to see the stages of cell division at the basal layer alone. Okay, but in the case of dysplasia, two things you will be able to see. One is increased mitotic figures. The second one is the presence of the mitotic figures in the superficial layers. And the third one is abnormal mitotic figures. So these are the three things that you're going to see with dysplasia. So I just want you guys to familiarize with these mitotic figures. So more than normal numbers, you're going to see more numbers of mitotic figures. So the red arrows are all pointing to these mitotic figures. So remember, in mitosis, the abnormal mitotic figures, when I say abnormal mitotic figures, there are three things. One is increased mitotic figures. The second one is the presence of mitotic figures in the superficial layers, where they are not supposed to be seen, because in a normal epithelium, only the basal layer has got the ability to undergo division. And the third one is abnormal mitotic figures. Now, I just want to show you like how these mitotic figures is going to appear in the histological sections. The various stages, how they are going to appear. In the prophase, what is going to see is that the nuclear membrane is going to disappear, and the chromatin is seen suspended in the cytoplasm. So that is what you are seeing here in the first picture. You can see the blue chromatin dispersed within the cytoplasm. Now, in the metaphase, what you're going to see that all these chromosomes are going to get arranged in the central part of the cell, in the equatorial region of the cell. This is known as the metaphase. And this is how you're going to see the picture. As you can see, this is how you're going to see the mitotic figure in a metaphase in a histology section. In the next anaphase, you're going to see that the chromosome material is going to be pulled to the either poles of the cell. Okay, so you can see in the picture here, you can see the chromosomal materials being pushed to the either poles of the cell. And that is known as the anaphase. In the last phase, you're going to see that the cells, the nuclear division has occurred, and now slowly the cytoplasmic, the nuclear division is slowly occurring, and the cytoplasmic division is slowly going to start. This is known as the telophase. And not only that, you can see some abnormal mitotic figures also. So here in these pictures are showing some of the abnormal mitotic figures, which are taken from an article JOPM. So this is some of the abnormal mitotic figures which I had seen in some of my cases. So here you can see the red arrow is pointing to a star-shaped mitotic figure. And here is another abnormal mitotic figure. So these are all the abnormal mitosis that you're going to, mitotic figures that you're going to see. One is mitotic activity that you're going to see. The one is increase in the number of mitotic figures, the presence of mitotic figures in the superficial layers, or the presence of abnormal mitotic figures. So these are all the abnormal mitotic activity that you're going to see in the case of dysplasia. Now, the next is the architectural features. In architectural features, you're going to see bulbous retiridges. Now, here is a normal histology, and you can see in a normal buccal mucosa, this is how the retinal ridges are going to appear like. But if it is a case of dysplasia, and you may see large large bulbous or drop-shaped retinal ridges like you can see here in a dysplasia. So, this is again another architectural feature. This actually signifies that the cells or the epithelial tissue as a whole is in a highly proliferative mode. So the next feature, the architectural feature is the loss of polarity. Now what do you mean by polarity? Polarity or polarization means the compartmentalization or like there is a separation between the different layers. The polarity means there are separation in these cells, epithelial cells into different layers. We say that the there is a division in the society. The other word for division in the society is polarity or polarization of the society. We hear that or read that regularly in the newspapers. Sometimes the society at certain times can get polarized based on religion, based on caste, based on language. The society can get polarized. So, the same way, there can be polarization of separation of the different layers of the cells in the epithelial tissue. So here you can see in a normal epithelium, there is always polarization or polarity is there. You can see the stratum basale, which is cuboidal or columnar cells. Then you have polygonal stratum spinosum. Then you have stratum granulosum on the top of that. Then you have stratum corneum on the top of that. This is what you mean by polarization. Now, when it comes to dysplasia, what is going to happen is that the cells which has got the morphological appearance of the stratum basale, that is a dividing group of cells. Remember, stratum basale is the dividing group of cells. These group of cells, there is a proliferation of this particular type of cells and they will fill up the whole of the histology or the whole of the epithelial or the epithelial compartment. So, this polarity is lost or this separation into stratum basale, stratum spinosum and stratum granulosum is lost and the whole of the epithelial compartment will be filled with, at different levels, it will be filled with cells with hypochromatic nuclei resembling like that of a stratum basale. So, this is what we can see here. This is again a histologic picture of a dysplastic tissue. So, you can see that the hypochromatic cells which appear like basal cells are filling up the whole epithelial compartment. Okay, so when you see something like this, we can see that the polarity or the separation of stratum basale, spinosum, granulosum and corneum based on their morphological appearance is completely lost in a dysplastic lesion, in a dysplastic histology, and that is what you mean by loss of polarity. The next is dyskeratosis or abnormal keratinization pattern. So, two things can happen. There is So, when you talk about a normal keratinization pattern, you know that in the previous slide we have seen that the normal keratinization you are supposed to see on the surface in the stratum corneum. You are not supposed to see them in the middle layers or like in the bottom layers. You are supposed to see them in the superficial layer, that is the stratum corneum. That is how the proper maturation happens. The last layers are the ones which undergoes proper keratinization. But when it comes to dysplasia, you start seeing that even the lower layers, they show features of keratinization. This is known as dyskeratosis. This is occurring because of the mutations that is occurring in the cells and the cells are not behaving in a normal manner and the normal maturation pattern is lost. So, the next feature that we are going to see is the dyskeratosis is the keratin pearl formation. So, look at the normal histology. In the normal histology, you will see that the keratin production is there in the stratum corneum part, that is a superficial part. Okay, but when it comes to dyskeratosis in a keratin pearl formation, sometimes you will see that the keratin formation will occur in the down layers or the bottom layers also. That's not supposed to happen, but that is happening because the cells have undergone so much of mutation that their normal maturation pattern is gone and they will start showing these bizarre features of keratinization. So, here you can see a dysplastic histology where the keratin pearl formation is there, where the keratin is produced in the lower layers, where on the stratum spinosum layers, where you can see that there are concentric rings of keratin formation. In the section, you will see the most concentric rings. That is why they are known as keratin pearl. So, the blue arrow, the yellow arrows are all pointing to this keratin pearl formation. Next is, you may see in the stratum spinosum layer, some individual cell keratinization. Each cell, one cell alone is undergoing keratinization. That is known as individual cell keratinization. The yellow arrow is pointing to an individual cell keratinization. The last one is the loss of cohesion. We know that the most characteristic feature of an epithelium is cell-to-cell junctions by means of desmosomes. They are highly adherent to one another by means of desmosomes. But when it becomes a dysplastic lesion, when it is moving towards cancer, they have a tendency to invade into the underlying connective tissue. Okay, they have a tendency to break the base membrane and invade into the underlying connective tissue as islands or as individual cells. So before that, they are going to slowly loosen up their junction with the adjacent cells. Or there is a loss of cohesion, or the desmosomal junctions are going to become weak and they're going to break, and the cells have got the tendency to enter into the connective tissue. So here I'm going to show you the with arrows certain areas where the cells have lost their attachment to the adjacent cells in a high power view. So here the yellow arrows are all pointing to the area where the epithelial cells are breaking the junctions, or the junctions between the epithelial cells are broken and they have a tendency to invade into the connective tissue, and this is what you mean by loss of cohesion. So this is all about the different dysplastic features. So it's very important that you need to remember and understand what are these dysplastic features. It should be there on your fingertips, this dysplastic lesion, dysplastic features. These dysplastic features are going to be seen if you are looking for a leukoplakia, if you are looking for a erythroplakia, or if you are evaluating for a submucous fibrosis. Other than the histology of submucous fibrosis, if you want to look for dysplastic lesions, it's all going to be the same. For actinic keratitis, they may have their own characteristic histologic features, but more than that, what we are interested is whether they have dysplasia or not. If it is there, how close is that towards cancer? That how much close is that to cancer can be measured by doing the grading. So we will discuss about grading in the later slides or in the later discussions. So thank you so much for your patient listening.